Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sue Lawley, and on behalf of the BBC, I'd like to welcome you to the JFK Presidential Library and Museum for the first in this year's series of four lectures to be given by Dr. Atul Gawande. Our thanks to our hosts here at the library, and in particular to its director, Tom Putnam, for having us here. Stunning building, stunning views. Just a pity the weather wasn't quite as stunning today as it was yesterday, but thank you for journeying through the rain to be with us this evening. We much appreciate it. Let me briefly, we're not recording yet, just give you an idea of what's going to happen tonight, and most importantly, your part in it, because you have a large part to play. Let me tell you a little bit about the background of the Reith Lectures. They've been running since 1948, so this is their 66th year, in memory of Lord Reith, the founding father of the BBC. The first lecturer was the philosopher and mathematician Bertrand Russell, and a couple of years ago, we had the Burmese political leader Aung San Suu Kyi. So you see, I mean, all kinds of people, all kinds of distinguished people in their field, whether they're historians, philosophers, architects, musicians, economists. Among those more recently here in the USA, Jeffrey Sachs, the economist, has given the lectures, and Neil Ferguson, the historian. We also, not very long ago, had the political philosopher Michael Sandel, professor of government at Harvard University, who I'm very happy to say is with us here this evening. Welcome, Michael, and his wife, Kiku. Lovely to see you again. So you get the feel of what the Reith Lectures are. By definition, as I say, these are distinguished public intellectuals, and the object of the exercise over a range of four lectures is for them to put forward an original thesis aimed to encourage public debate on issues which affect all of our lives. And indeed, this year, topically, as it turns out, in the light or darkness of the Ebola outbreak, it's medicine and public health that is in under the microscope. Our objective, as well as to provide you with an interesting and interactive, she keeps saying, I'm going to plug away at you because we do want you involved, an interactive night on the town, we also want to make a very good radio program. And so that people, tens of thousands of people, can share the experience we have here this evening. Because not only is this programme going out on BBC Radio 4, which is the UK's highly regarded, much acclaimed, highly successful speech-based radio station, terrific it is too, it's also going to be transmitted across the world via the BBC's World Service. So as far as you're concerned, as well as hearing the programme here this evening, it will be broadcast beginning across 4 weeks, beginning the last week in November. You'll also be able to read the full transcript on the BBC's website. You'll be able to hear them again if you want to hear how we edit these things on the Listen Again facility, and it'll also be available to download as a podcast. So these lectures will certainly be out there for everyone. If you're interested in past Reiths, by the way, I would recommend you to the Reith website, which is it's got practically the whole 66-year archive there. It's an intellectual treasure trove, fascinating. The structure of this evening is that in a moment I shall record an introduction for broadcast, and I shall welcome Dr. Gawande. I shall then chat to him briefly here, just for a couple of minutes. He'll then deliver the lecture, and then I shall join him back on the stage and for another half an hour or so of questions with you. I urge you to explore and to challenge Atul's views if you want to. I'm sure you know that he's happy to engage in vigorous debate, and this isn't a time to be reverential. And really, it's not. And also, we know that, you know, the simplest questions can elicit the most interesting answers. So don't hold back. We very much need to know you're here. This is radio, so we need to feel your presence. So if you want to applaud or laugh or cry or whatever you want to do, feel free. But if you get a fit of coughing, perhaps you'd leave the room. Please will you turn your telephones to silent, but put them in airplane mode. I mean, if you want to tweet, and it's hashtag Reith, R-E-I-T-H, we're happy for that to happen, but we don't... But actually, you can go onto the Wi-Fi that's available in the building, and that's very easy. Then we don't get that kind of searching for signals, which interferes with our network and our recording. So if you do that, we'd be very pleased. Could I also ask you at the very end of the recording, don't rush for the exits. There's always a danger that the equipment has failed and we have to do the whole thing again. I hope and believe that is a low probability, but we do just need a few minutes to check quite genuinely. But also the controller of Radio 4, who's here on the front row, Gwyneth Williams, would like to say a few words before you go. Oh, and after that, Atul will be signing his books in the shop out there if you'd like to get one of those. But don't keep him for long because we're going upstairs to dinner. Okay, I think if... my bosses at the back are ready. They'll sort of whisper something nice in my ear in a minute and tell me that they're ready to record. They're ready to record. What I might just do is have a quick slurp of water. Excuse me. My earring is rattling, is it? I might take the earrings off. I think earrings off is a good idea. Don't let me forget them. It's just rattling against all these various microphones and tubes. You see, Atul's going to operate on me halfway through this evening. Okay, need a bit of light here. Okay, here we go. Hello and welcome to the first of the 2014 Reith Lectures. We're at the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum in Boston, a dramatic concrete and glass building overlooking Massachusetts Bay, the nation's official memorial to its 35th president. He was a president who inspired a generation with his message of the empowering strength of ideas. Too often, said Kennedy, we enjoy the comfort of opinion without the discomfort of thought. An observation that might have been taken as a text for this year's Reith lecturer, who admits that he's in what he calls the disturbance business. He's a Harvard professor of medicine, so Boston now is his hometown too, but his abilities as a doctor and surgeon are complemented by his skills as a writer, thinker, and political analyst, and he's become one of the world's leading thinkers on public health. His lectures are called The Future of Medicine, but his subject matter is as much about attitudes, systems, and human behavior as it is about new frontiers in medical research. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the BBC's 2014 Reith Lecturer, Atul Gawande. Atul, just before we begin, a few more questions, just so we really understand where you're coming from. Well, a little better anyway. It's obvious, looking across your career, that politics is in your blood as much as medicine is. You worked for Bill Clinton when you were a very young man, didn't you? Well, you're a young man now, but...
I wish I were still young. I went to work for him when he ran for president, and at the time I was just 26 years old, but you had to move to Little Rock, and there weren't a lot of people who thought at that time he was... even going to make it out of the primary. So I ended up being his health and social policy advisor, living in Little Rock and riding it all the way to the White House.
And so you went to Washington as well, did you?
Yes, I ended up on the task force working on, at that time, the failed health reform program that went up in 1993 and went down the same year.
But in the end, surgery won over politics. Why was that?
Couple of things. One is that I wanted to be less dependent on the fortunes of others in making my own career. I wanted to be able to develop and voice my own ideas. And then there was this desire to have some skill besides just being at the abstract level of policy and work at that level. So I returned to medical school instead of taking up the offer to work on welfare reform.
But it was more than that, wasn't it? Because I know you said you were mesmerized, actually, by the operating theater. That's what gets you.
Yeah, well, when I came back to medical school, I thought I will enter into a field that would be compatible with going quickly back into public affairs and public policy, internal medicine, something with a shorter residency, and then in the operating room, I kind of loved the blood and guts of it all. I loved the sense of skill. In a funny way, I also found I liked the way that surgeons had to think, and it reminded me of politics in some way, that the really good surgeons had to be like really good politicians in being willing to take chances, deal with risk, know that your knowledge and your skills are uncertain.
And have a necessity to act.
And have the necessity to act.
That's the point, really, isn't it?
And then live with the consequences when you take action, and often works out well, but doesn't always.
So you like being on the line?
I liked people who knew how to handle that. I didn't think of myself as that kind of person. My favorite New Yorker cartoon was the one that I thought fit me. It was the one that has a gravestone that said, "He kept his options open."
Well, you certainly do all of that. You do so much. I mean, and you write for the New Yorker as well. You do everything. I mean, one's amazed you fit it all in, I have to say.
Well, I don't know if it's everything, but I get to fit together a lot of things that I love, and sometimes you jam too much together, but it's hard for me to want to give up anything from having the chance to take care of people to writing and research.
But as I quoted you as saying that you're in the disturbance business. Who do you want to disturb with these Reith lectures?
I think all of us. I like digging into, and we'll get to talk about it, I like digging into the complexities of reality and what we really face, pulling back the veil, so to speak, and then trying to see if we can find our way through the complexities.
Well, there are four lectures. This is the first. It's called Why Do Doctors Fail? Ladies and gentlemen, Atul Gawande.
Every family has its pivotal medical moments. Ours as a family, one of ours, was in July 1995 when my son Walker then was just 11 days old. He had difficulty taking his feedings. He couldn't hold anything down, and we took him to the pediatrician. The pediatrician put her stethoscope on his chest, listened for a moment, and then looked at us and said, "There's something wrong with his heart, and we needed to take him to the hospital right away." I think there are millions of moments like this one that occur every day, a human being coming to another human being with their body or their mind's troubles and looking for their assistance. And that is the central act of medicine, that moment when another human being turns to another human being for help. And it always struck me how small and limited and improbable that moment is, that moment, the thought that any help could be offered. We have 13 different organ systems, and at latest count, we've identified more than 60,000 ways that they can go awry. The body is scarily intricate, unfathomable, hard to read. We are these hidden beings inside this fleshy sack of skin, and we've spent thousands of years trying to understand what's been going on inside. You open it up and it bleeds, it gets infected. We've spent an enormous amount of time, millennia really, tinkering largely ineffectively or worse along the way. So the story of medicine to me is the story of how we deal with the incompleteness of our knowledge and the fallibility of our skills. And that to my surprise, became the basis of all of my writing and then research over what's been now almost 2 decades. And I couldn't be more grateful for the chance of this lecture to try to pull it all together into the themes that I think have come from some of it. There was an essay that I read 2 decades ago that I think has influenced almost every bit of writing and research I've done ever since, and it was by 2 philosophers, Samuel Gorovitz and Alistair MacIntyre. They wrote an essay in 1976 on the nature of human fallibility. What they wondered was, why do human beings fail at anything that we set out to do? Why, for example, would a meteorologist fail to correctly predict where a hurricane was going to make landfall? Or why might a doctor fail to figure out what was going on inside my son and fix it? They said there are 2 primary reasons why we might fail. Number 1 is ignorance. We have only a limited understanding of all of the relevant physical laws and conditions that apply to any given problem or circumstance. The 2nd reason, however, they called ineptitude, meaning that the knowledge exists, but an individual or a group of individuals fail to apply that knowledge correctly. Now, we've relied on science to overcome ignorance, and the course of that work has itself been incredibly fascinating. That pediatrician visit we made and everything that she did to sort out what was happening in my son could be traced back to 1628 and William Harvey, when, after millennia of pondering, he finally was the one who sorted out that the heart is a pump moving blood in a circular course through the body. That was when he figured it out, and therefore we figured it out. And then another critical step came not for 3 more centuries, not until 1929, when a surgical intern in Eberswalde, Germany, made an observation. His name was Werner Forstmann, and he was just reading some medical journals, an obscure one, actually. It had animal studies, and it had the picture of a horse where they'd threaded a tube up the leg of the horse all the way into the heart, and then described what was going on from taking blood from there. And he said, well, if we could do that to a horse, what if we did that to a human being? And he went to his superiors, to his bosses, and said, how about we take a tube and thread it into a human being's heart? And they said, you're crazy. You can't do that. We know whenever you touch the heart, when people have attempted it in surgery, it goes into fibrillation and the patient dies. You cannot do this. And he said, well, what about in an animal? There's no point. And you're just an intern anyway. Who says you should even deserve to get to ask these questions? Go back to work. Well, he just had to know. And so what he did was he stole into the x-ray room, took a urinary catheter, made a slit in his own arm, threaded it up the vein and into his own heart, and convinced a nurse to help him take a series of 9 x-rays showing the tube inside his own heart. He was fired. And then in 1956, he was awarded the Nobel Prize with André Cournand, who took his findings some 20 years later at Columbia University, and then recognized that you could not only put the catheter into a person's heart, but shoot dye into the heart. And that would let you take pictures, and you could see the living heart and how it actually worked from the inside. What they'd done was they had founded the field of cardiology. Because now you could see inside the heart and understand how the valves worked and how the heart's function really operated, and also what happens when it's not working. And then in the 1960s and 1970s and 1980s, one by one, we began devising techniques and ways to actually fix what was going on inside the heart. Science is concerned with universalities, universal truths, laws of how the body or the world behaves. Application, however, is concerned with the particularities. And the test is how the universalities apply to the particularities. Do the general ideas about the sounds the pediatrician heard in my son's chest, do those general ideas correspond with the unique particularities of Walker? And here, Gorevitz and McIntyre saw a third possible kind of failure. Besides ignorance, besides ineptitude, they said that there is necessary fallibility, some knowledge science can never deliver on. They went back to the example of how a given hurricane will behave, when it will make landfall, how fast it will be going when it does. And what they said is that we're asking science to do more than it can when we ask it to tell us just what exactly is going on. All hurricanes are ones that follow predictable laws of behavior, but no hurricane is like any other hurricane. Each one is unique. And a perfect understanding of a hurricane would require a perfect understanding of the myriad, even more complex factors going on around the hurricane in the entire environment. What's going on in the Gulf Stream? What's going on in the polar ice cap? We therefore cannot have perfect knowledge of our hurricane short of having a complete understanding of all the laws that describe natural processes and a complete state description of the world, they said. It required, in other words, omniscience. We can't have that. So then the interesting question is, how do we cope? Now, it's not that it's impossible to predict anything. Some things are completely predictable, and they gave the example of a random ice cube in a fire. An ice cube is so simple and so like all the other ice cubes that you can have complete assurance that you put it in the fire, it will melt. The everyday question for us, however, is, are human beings more like hurricanes, or are we more like ice cubes? So we take Walker to the emergency room here in town, in Boston. It's a Sunday morning. A nurse takes an oxygen monitor, one of those finger probes with the red light, and puts it on the finger of his right hand. And the oxygen level is 98%, virtually perfect. They get a chest x-ray. And the chest x-ray shows that the lungs are both whited out. They read it, they said this is a pneumonia. They did a spinal tap to make sure that it wasn't signs of infection that had spread from a meningitis. They started him on antibiotics. And they called the pediatrician to let her know the diagnosis they'd found. It wasn't the heart, they said. It was the lungs, a pneumonia. And she said, no, that can't be true. And so she came into the emergency room, and she took one look at him, and he was having trouble breathing. He was not doing great. And she saw that the finger probe with the oxygen monitor was on the wrong finger. Now, it turns out there are certain conditions where the aorta can be interrupted. you can be born with an incomplete aorta. And so the blood flow can come out of the heart and go to the right side of the body and to the hand that had that probe, but it may not go to the left side of the body or anywhere else in the body. And that turned out to be what was going on. She switched the probe over to the left hand, and he had an unreadable oxygen level. He was, in fact, when we got the lab results back, going into kidney and liver failure from lack of blood flow to anywhere below the diaphragm. He was in serious trouble. And she had caught a failure to apply the knowledge we had to this given situation. And then the team made a prediction that in this situation, we do have a drug, only invented, it turned out, only discovered in about a decade before my son was born. Prostaglandin E2, a little molecule that can reopen the fetal circulation. When you're a fetus in the womb, you have a bypass system that sends a separate set of blood supply that can stay open for a couple weeks after birth. It had shut down, and that's why he went into failure. But this molecule can reopen that pathway. And the prediction was that this child was like every other child, that you could know what had happened to other children and could apply it here, and that it would open up that fetal circulation, this bypass system. And it did. That gave him time to recover, to let his kidney and his liver recover, to let his gut start working again, and then to undergo, a few days later, after he'd recovered in the intensive care unit, undergo cardiac surgery to replace his malformed aorta and to fix the holes that were present in his heart as well. They saved him. They saved him. There's, I think, in more and more ways, signs that we are as knowable as ice cubes. We understand with great precision how mothers can die in childbirth, how certain tumors behave, how the Ebola virus spreads, how the heart can go wrong and be fixed. We have many, many areas of continuing ignorance. Alzheimer's disease and what we can do about it, metastatic cancers, how we might make a vaccine against this virus we're dealing with now. But the story of our time, I think, has now become in a unique way as much a story about struggling with ineptitude as struggling with ignorance. You know, you go back just a few decades, go back 100 years, and we lived in a world where our futures were governed largely by ignorance. But in this last century, we've come through an extraordinary explosion of discovery. And then the puzzle has become not only how we close the continuing gaps of ignorance open to us, but also how we ensure that the knowledge gets there, that the finger probe is on the right finger. In the ICU next to him was a child from Maine, about 200 miles away, who had virtually the same diagnosis that Walker had. And when he was diagnosed, it was too long before the problem was recognized. Transportation could be arranged, and he could get that drug to give him back that open circulation. And the result was that poor child with the same condition my son had, in that very next bed to us, had gone into complete liver and kidney failure. And his only chance while we were waiting there was that he was waiting for an organ transplant to give him some chance at a future that was going to be very different from what my son had gotten to have. And then I think back on my family. My father comes from a rural village in India, my mother from a big city in the north of India. And if Walker had been anything like my 37 nieces and nephews in the rural village where my family still has our farm. We're still farmers raising wheat, a kind of wheat, and sugarcane and cotton. And if he'd been there, there'd have been no chance at all. There's a misconception, I think, about global health. We think global health is about care in just the poorest parts of the world. But the way I think about global health, it's about the idea of making care better everywhere. The idea that we are trying to deploy the capabilities that we have discovered over the last century, town by town, to every person alive. We've had an extraordinary transformation around the world. Economically, even with the last recession, we've had the rising of the global economies on every continent. And the result has been a dramatic change in the length of lives all across the world. We've shifted to a world where we've gone from respiratory illness and malnutrition being the biggest killers in the world to one where it's now cardiovascular disease, to where road traffic accidents are a top five killer and cancers are in the top 10. And with that economic progress has come the knowledge that solutions exist. My family in our village in India know that solutions exist to the problems that we have. And so the puzzle is how we deploy that capability everywhere. In India, in Maine, across the UK, Europe, Latin America, the world. And we're only just discovering the patterns of how we might begin to do that. The striking thing is that there is enormous variation. There is a bell curve in the results you're likely to get for any given condition, depending on where you are in the world. There is enormous variation, that bell curve, between countries. But the variation is actually bigger within countries, within India, within the United States, within UK and Europe, everywhere. You can see from the bottom to the top and everything in between. Now, variation is incredibly interesting to me, and I think that has been the case for a long time, and I think it may come from the seeds that became the person who is a writer now and a researcher. Variation to me is gold. The common faith of both science and writing is that there is a power to observation and understanding variation. And there is an importance to transparency about the variation that exists in the world. 100 years ago, we couldn't see inside our hearts until Forsman and Cournand could show us what happens inside and let you see the variation that happened. Today, we can't see inside our systems. We can't see inside our clinics and our emergency rooms and our operating rooms. We're just starting to open those doors. And I think what happened for me just about 20 years ago now was that I got to rediscover the art of, almost the lost art, of the simple case study that had been such a powerful tool in the 19th century and before in medicine, the simple observation of the detailed case. But I read Oliver Sacks when I was a medical student, and seeing his description of the man who mistook his wife for a hat and these many other detailed case studies made me think that this was something that perhaps I could do, only I turned it onto observation of the system surrounding the body more than the body. One of my first articles for the New Yorker magazine was an article about a mistake that I had made that nearly killed a patient and mistakes that I'd observed colleagues to make in my own hospital. And from that came now what's nearly 100 articles and investigations for the New Yorker and other magazines and 4 books. I'd investigated the most expensive town for healthcare in the world. I'd investigated the learning curve and how we have to learn in medicine and practice upon people. Most recently, I looked at what happens as we've turned aging and the end of our lives into a medical experience, what really happens when that has occurred. And I've had a chance to extend these ideas to research as well. One of the earliest studies that our team did was a study of medical records from 15,000 patients at hospitals in the middle part of the United States. We were looking at all of the cases where people came into the hospital and they either died or ended up severely disabled when they left. They had a complication of care. And what we found was a third of the time the complication seemed to be because of ignorance. We just didn't have all the knowledge to know what to do to avoid certain kinds of risks and circumstances. But two-thirds of the time, they were due to avoidable error, due to what Gorvitz and McIntyre would have labeled ineptitude. And then there's been an explosion of ways that we are able to investigate further. Colleagues of mine have done studies where they've sent mystery shoppers, so to speak, fake patients who could act and turn up at doctor's offices with the exact symptoms of tuberculosis or cholera, and deployed them in Asia and Latin America, and found that two-thirds of the time, we don't even recognize the diagnosis that we're coming in and bringing in front of them. We've bought audio tape, videotapes, being able to unfold and create an incredible potential of flowering where we can ask, why do our systems fail? Why are these different components not working the way we want? How could we make them better? And also, by the way, start to discover what can't be improved, where the necessary fallibility is. In the coming lectures, I'm hoping to be able to unpack three ideas. First is what we're learning from opening the door, from seeing behind the curtains of medicine and health, and discovering how much can be done that saves lives and reduces suffering. Number two is having a chance to look at the reality of our necessary fallibility and how we cope effectively with the fact that our knowledge is always limited. And then number three is the chance to look at the implications of both of these, what we're learning about our ineptitude and about our necessary fallibility, and what they mean for the global future of medicine. Now, it is uncomfortable looking inside our fallibility. We have a fear of looking. The place we've come to is that we're like the doctors who dug up the bodies in the 19th century in order to dissect them, in order to know what was really happening inside. When we looked inside the bodies, or we look inside our systems and how they really work, they're messier than we knew, and sometimes messier than we might have wanted to know. In some ways, I think, you know, turning on the cameras inside our world is more treacherous at times. There's a reason that Gorvitz and McIntyre labeled the kind of failures we have ineptitude. There's a sense that there's some shame or guilt to the fact that we don't get it right all the time. And exposing it can make people more angry than exposing the fact that we're simply ignorant about certain ideas. And therefore, we've blocked many of these efforts to try to provide some transparency to what's going on. The audio tapes are often not allowed. The video recorders are turned off. We have no black box for what happens in our operating rooms or in our clinics. The data, when we have it, is often locked up. You can't know, even though we have the information, which hospitals have a better complication rate in certain kinds of operations than others. There's a fear of misuse, a fear of injustice in doing it, in exposing it. But arguably, there are lives at stake from not opening up the doors. And I think we also will miss out on the chance that what we get to find can often be miraculous. Walker, they told us when he went home, Walker was going to need a second operation. The repair that he'd had was one that replaced the tube, the aorta, the tube coming out of his heart to carry blood supply throughout the rest of the body. And that tube had been replaced, but in an 11-day-old child. It was almost like a straw. Now, they had put it in such a way that it could grow a little bit. It could expand as he grew, but it was not going to accommodate an adult-sized body. And so they told us he would have to, when he became a teenager, you know, get a new replacement aorta, and that it would be a risky thing he would have to undergo. And being a surgery resident, I knew what that entailed. It was a 5% chance of death and a 25% chance of paralysis, and we lived in some fear about when that moment would come. But when it came, when he was 14 years old, the world had changed. And that by then, technology had developed to allow the aorta to be expanded with a simple catheter. We found the expert who had learned and even devised some of the methods for being able to do that right here in Boston. He explained to me, you know, cardiologist to surgeon, just how it's done, and sometimes you learn stuff you don't necessarily want to know. He talked about the idea that, you know, you have to apply pressure to a balloon that would be threaded up into the aorta. And you know what? He can really feel the vessel tearing, and that the trick is to tear it just enough that it can expand, but not so much that it ruptures. There was a necessary fallibility to what he was going to do. But he knew how to do it. He knew what the feel was. And Walker ended up getting through that procedure just fine. The extraordinary thing was the very next day, he went home. And the day after that, he was well enough to play sports and injure his ankle on the playing field. This June, he graduated from high school. And this fall, he entered college. He's going to live a long and normal life, which is amazing. And the key question we have to ask ourselves is, how are we going to make it possible for others to have that? How do we fulfill our duty to make it possible for others? And the only way I can see is by removing the veil around what happens in that procedure room, in that clinic, in that office or that hospital. Only by making what has been invisible visible. This is why I write. This is why we do the science we do. Because this is how we understand. And that, to me, is the key to the future of medicine. Thank you.
Atul Gawande, thank you very much indeed. Okay, hold those thoughts because we've just got to pause for a moment and take some questions before we take some questions from the floor because I have to record a couple of separate links that will be used in the World Service versions of this program. So if you're going to bear with me, if you would, then... And one of them has to be precisely 29 seconds long. Don't ask me why. But you can time me. I'm going to do this one. Okay, it's called a billboard. It says here, first half out. I don't know what that means. Sounds like a baseball game. okay, here we go. Why do doctors fail? That's the question Atul Gawande has been tackling for this year's Reith Lecture. Coming up, he's going to be taking questions from the audience and a few from me, Sue Lawley, here at the JFK Presidential Library and Museum in Boston. Do we expect too much from our doctors, or perhaps we're not demanding enough. You can follow the conversation on Twitter, hashtag Reith, R-E-I-T-H. But first, a summary of the world news. 29 seconds, we're all right. And another little short one before we go on, okay? Welcome back to Boston and the JFK Presidential Library and Museum. We've just heard from the surgeon and writer Atul Gawande why he thinks doctors fail. Now we're going to hear the views of our audience here as they put his ideas to the test. So, we're fine. Now we're back on the page. So, Atul has finished his lecture. You're brimming with questions. Could I ask you, just as I deliver this little link, to applaud once more as if Atul's just finished his lecture. Atul Gawande, thank you very much indeed for that thought-provoking lecture. Now, let me open up the subject of why doctors fail to our audience here in the JFK Presidential Library in Boston. Who's going to give me my first question? A sea of hands, I hope to see. There's a gentleman here on the front row we can go to, and there's a gentleman there just behind, and we'll come to you second. If you'd like to remain seated, if you would, and what I'd like you all to do is, before you put your question, to tell us your name and who you are or what you do, just so we get an idea of where you're coming from.
I'm Tom Putnam, the director of the Kennedy Library, and again, it's our great honor to host this evening's lecture, and I want to thank Dr. Gawande for that fascinating talk that engaged us not only intellectually, but without cutting your vein, we got a glimpse of your heart. I imagine one of the greatest frustrations of a doctor is that when you see someone who is ill and offer a prescription, they sometimes don't follow it. And as you indicated in your talk, you're offering, in essence, prescriptions to your fellow doctors and to the medical establishment on ways to improve their practice and achieve better results. So in your experience, are doctors more or less likely to follow your suggested remedies as your patients?
In both cases, I can't blame them entirely, right? Part of the science of it is understanding and trying to get inside why these things don't happen. We're coaching nurses in India, and one of the things that we have to think about and observe is what their lives are like. Can you blame them if they don't wash their hands if there's no water available? And yet at the same time, there are solutions. The potential of bringing a basin of water. How can you arrange for a janitor to bring it into the clinic to have it there? Same way here, one of the studies I looked at, wrote about a couple books ago, feel very relevant at this moment, was about why it can be so difficult to have people washing hands and putting gowns and gloves on properly. And there are turn out to be an enormous number of steps along the way. If you have very many people to see or pressure of activities, it's not hard to imagine why we don't adhere. Same way with our patients. We ask them to stay on a gazillion drugs, take them faithfully, moment by moment. But even in the best of hands, even the most diligent of people, we have ways that we fail to follow along because it's hard, the variety of complexities. So, you know, my bottom line is that I think that we are capable of sometimes simplifying and making solutions that allow us to be more effective along the way. While recognizing that sometimes it really is just motivation and people just don't want to do it, and that we have to also think about ways we capture the intrinsic motivations people have, and sometimes the extrinsic ones, which can be the way we pay people, the way we reward them, and so on. All of that is part of what we have to unpack, the barriers and the motivations.
But you said during the course of your lecture, you know, we can't see inside our clinics, we can't see inside our emergency rooms. Did you mean that literally we should be able to, that you should be able to have cameras on the walls so that you can see exactly what goes on and see where things go wrong?
Yeah, it depends on the you know, one of the things that happens is how we use the cameras, right? Or how we use the data. If it's to have a police state at which we're turning on the lights and capturing the data in order to punish, then no surprise, you find broken cameras. if it's for, and this is a fine line to walk, if it's for improvement, knowledge and transparency, then it's much more likely that everyone is willing to go along with the project. Now, what's hard is you can't control, to some extent, how information is used. You know, consumer reports, you know, these kinds of reports on cars and appliances and everything else, plenty of manufacturers would love to see some of that transparency go away. Sure. And they've had to protect that knowledge staying out there. And sometimes it is misinterpreted and misused and it's not fair, but the trend, the direction, the arrow of progress is forward. It feeds far more information, helps even the manufacturers change what they provide. And so what we've seen is that when we provide information about what is really happening, it's far less likely when we open the doors, show the video, show the data of what's really going on in the clinics, it's far less likely that the world runs screaming in terror, and much more likely that they actually use that information to improve.
Hmm. Okay, there's a lady on the front row. I keep going to the front row, but I do want something. Yes, we'll have a standby at the back there, Tom, with that.
As a patient.
Could you tell us your name?
My name is Edith Richman, and I'm originally from New York, and I've had very similar experiences that you've talked about. Well, I don't have a consumer's report for medicine. Now, how do I know when I go to a doctor that he has good diagnostic skills to determine what I need in medicine?
And you're correct, you can't. You can't right now. You know, even when we needed to find doctors for my own son, for my wife, for other people in our family, all we really have to go on is the tried and true of you ask around to colleagues, you find out about reputation. You very rarely have much data to go on. Now, it's starting to change. You can go online these days and look up whether your doctor has been arrested under any kind of criminal prosecution and whether they have an active license. All right, it's a useful bar. You know, you can go also now on Yelp and find out if there are any kind of patient complaints, but, you know, I never know what to make of people who are simply cranky. And any more than I know what to do with all the people complaining about the hotels that I look at online. And so, you know, we're kind of in between those worlds without a real adequate window in. You know, the value is most importantly that we start to open the door and allow some of that information in. The Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, which is a foundation for this genetic disease of afflicting kids, decided 3 years ago that they would open up the data on all 117 centers that treat children with cystic fibrosis in the country, show the actual survival rates. It showed the bell curves. The differences in survival were below 25 years in some places and as high as 47 years in others. Some of the centers threatened to leave. The parents of these children ended up finding it an incredibly valuable resource. And the interesting and fascinating thing is that very few ended up leaving their centers, but their centers ended up saying, whoa, look at this place that's at the top of the bell curve. We're going to visit that place and find out much more what they're doing. And so they all ended up moving up the chain and being able to shift and improve where they went. This is more of what we have to do in other fields as well.
Well, I have rejected a lot of what doctors have told me, and you know what? I was right.
I mean, this is the depressing message that's coming across here, really. We've been taught not to trust our politicians and our bankers, and now you're saying we can't trust our doctors.
Well, here's the reality. You are far better off putting yourselves in the hands of a medical profession than not. You know, we've had a century of incredible progress. We've added many years to people's lives and even more quality and productivity to people's lives. And yet, there is that bell curve. There is a wide variation in the results that people get. And so, you know, the potential that we have for being able to capture that ability, it's not that that kid in Maine couldn't trust their doctor. It's they didn't have a system that could assure that that child in Maine had the same chances that my son had.
But finding the diagnosis is detective work, isn't it? I mean, how can you arrive at it? Because you don't know whether it's going to be right.
Well, I suspect if we could have the camera on, we might have discovered a couple of things. One was that there are very clear ways of making sure that that probe is on the correct finger to begin with. But second is that after that is there, that you're able to connect all the dots, be able to get people transported when they need to be transported. You know, now it's much more teams of people that are trying to deliver on the knowledge and not just having that pediatrician with the stethoscope to the heart, but all the team of people that followed. And there are multiple breakdowns along the way that we find over and over again.
So you want to set out systems and rules and a protocol, almost a flow chart for diagnosis.
Well, we'll be able to talk about some of those ideas in a lecture to come.
Okay. I'm going to go to a question that we had standing by at the back there.
Yes, hello, my name is Mason Woolley, and a writer based in Boston. And my question is, how do you control between fallibility of diagnosis and diagnosing a condition which is inherently difficult to diagnose, like COPD, for example?
Well, so this is part of, there are a couple of things. One is that part of the uncomfortable nature of beginning to shine a light, whether it's through writing and in-depth diagnosis, understanding of where things go wrong by looking at individual cases or really looking across lots of them, is that there is some necessary fallibility. Diagnosis is can be made more of a science than an art, and yet it's like the hurricane. You will never be able to get it to 100% being able to make landfall. So, on the other hand, what we see is there's that wide bell curve that we know some places and people have approaches that are more effective and more systematic than others, and we haven't captured that. You know, if we know there's variability in the likelihood that a great diagnosis is made, we have not captured what the positive deviants are doing, what the outliers are doing that the others can learn from and capture.
Can I just, Ted, this gentleman here in the center of this row here. No, just come forward a bit. Here he is with his hand up. Yeah.
Very much appreciated your talk. My name is Dan Tarsay. I'm actually a professor of neurology at Harvard Medical School, and I have appreciated your books over the years, and thank you for them. I wanted to go back. You made a quick allusion to what's going on currently in this country regarding the Ebola scare and the Texas Presbyterian Hospital, which was allegedly a very fine institution, made some mistakes. We don't yet know the details of that, but there's a sense that things didn't go well. To what extent is there an egocentricity about physicians caring for patients, especially specialists, who feel they're at the state of the art, they know what there is to know, but possibly don't know what they don't know? To what extent did that hospital and its staff not know what they didn't know?
The unknown knowns?
Yes. I see there's a shadow of Rumsfeld around in this room somewhere.
Exactly. Here's the thing that has struck me about the difficulty in being able to get all the steps right with containing an Ebola virus. The steps have been standard public health infection control measures that have been around for a very long time. They mostly involve knowing how to isolate people effectively. The isolation doesn't require fancy rooms. It just requires a room with a closed door. It requires wearing some gloves and gowns and a mask that for 40 years of containing multiple outbreaks of Ebola, it hasn't required, you know, high-tech hazmat suits and and respirators. But the fundamental breakdowns and the really basic things like how you take a gown off without contaminating yourself is knowledge that we haven't had. And how do we know that we haven't had it? And how do we know that that Texas hospital is no different from others across the country, across much of the world? The answer is that 2 million people a year pick up infections in our hospitals in this country and many more in the world over, mostly because of our inability to follow those basic infection control practices. And our inability to do that mostly reflects our lack of recognition. You know, now that with Ebola, suddenly we can die. You know, it's like the pilots who, if they don't get the procedures right, they can die. You know, when we were the vectors of transmission, the SARS virus, when that outbreak happened half a decade ago, 10,000 people were killed within weeks, and it was almost entirely passed by healthcare workers. And we did not have this same kind of outcry, even though it was the same kinds of issues about basic hygiene and control. And so, you know, I think this is less about the unknowns and much more about that sense of, you know, we are resistant to the detail. Ironically, when I go into an operating room, we know exactly these details. You know, in many ways, I almost think that these are patients we should put into our operating rooms because those are places where we're used to following all of the sterile protocols and procedures without absentmindedly putting a glove to our own face.
Do you want to come back on that? Okay, another question. Where am I? A woman just behind you, look there. There we are.
My name is Grace McGathy. I'm a clinical social worker. At the beginning of your talk, you mentioned very briefly patients come to doctors both for physical ailments as well as ailments of the mind. And you also talked about our poor understanding of some physical ailments like Alzheimer's or metastatic cancer. How do we disrupt aspects of medicine that are so poorly understood that they are not treated well in general?
Yeah, there are a couple of things. I actually think there's a lot more known in mental health than we execute on. Some of our poorest performances in mental health care. We have known approaches, for example, in being effective. It's not necessarily easy, but being effective even with drug addiction, alcoholism, certainly with depression and manic depression. And you look at the number of people who are receiving the basic guidelines of care for alcoholism, depression, manic depression, bipolar disease. And we're talking about the vast majority not in our communities, not receiving the basic guidelines that we have established. In many ways, it's a crisis of low expectations. It's also that people are unlikely to come forward with their illnesses because of stigma attached to it. Also, public sense that, you know, maybe we can't do anything. But then even within our profession, when we have people who are recognized with major conditions in our emergency rooms, in our clinics, if they're not in the mental health part of the system, they fall between the cracks. The basic skills haven't carried over. I think much of that is potentially, we have ways to begin to change that.
There's a gentleman on the back row. I thought we ought to have somebody from the back row. Didn't I see a hand go up round about where the microphone is there now? Is there a gentleman at the back? No? All hands gone. Okay. Yeah? Okay. There we are.
I also want to thank you very much for a terrific talk and for your writing and research over the years.
Can you tell us who you are?
Yes, I'm Rick Pollack. I'm a family doctor. And I tend to think of my patients and my work much more in the hurricane realm than I do in the ice cube realm. And one of the concerns that I have is that much of both the research and even more importantly, the application of the research by bureaucrats, regulators, insurers, tends to interpret the information as an ice cube and not as a hurricane. And I find as a family doctor on the front lines that in some ways it disempowers my patients from helping to determine what kind of care they wish to receive. Because not only am I measured as a good or a bad clinician by following guidelines, many of which don't have very good evidence behind them, including the bipolar and depression guidelines you just mentioned, but indeed I'm paid more to convince my patients to do something that they may not wish to do based on a really good values clarification discussion that I'm now disincented to have with them. I'm curious about how we guard against unintended consequences of the measurable displacing the important, especially in where I live in the primary care world.
To me, this is a cost of our invisibility. We have very little window into how hard your job is. I'll give you an example. We did a recent study where we took one medical clinic here in Boston, down by Fenway Park, and we looked at how many diagnoses came in the doors of that clinic in the course of a year. We used the International Disease Classification System 9, which has 13,000 diagnoses, and we found that in a year, they had 6,000 diagnoses come in the door, that the average family physician or internist ended up seeing 400 new diagnoses in a year. That in fact, the job that the person has who sits in your role is one of dealing with immense variety most of the time. We have taken the view that you look at the statistics in a certain way and it says, well, 80% of patients are here for have diabetes, high blood pressure, or coronary artery disease, and you know, just learn how to take care of a few of those basic things and it'll all work out. Well, the trouble is that what we saw was the diabetic is diabetic, but they're coming in because they've got an eye injury, or because they've got a belly pain, or because they've got a toenail problem. And the variety is what ends up being the difficulty of managing and being able to make that system work. I think in many ways that if we're able to shine more of a light and let people get more of a feel for how complex that job is, that we would begin to reinvent that job. We're already in the process of beginning to do that, starting to, you know, provide more resources, put more teams around people in those environments, start to reinvent the way we go about it. How do we use the computers and the information technology capabilities much more effectively? You know, treat people who need much more time and complexity in ways that are very different from the people who just need a quick routine kind of entry or even connection by email or other means. We're in this experiment, which is pretty young actually, of reinventing the entire way we approach that moment. And the lack of visibility into what is that hurricane of patients coming through the door, how various and unmanageable some components are, and how manageable others are, I think would increase sympathy rather than decrease it for what happens in our jobs. I think it's not unlike the police who are asked to, you know, have video for their interrogations. They've feared it and avoided it, but as they start turning on the cameras and allow people to see more and more, you've let people into the complexity. And
it's
made a difference.
But all of this takes time, Atul, doesn't it? And of course, the thing that doctors don't have for all kinds of reasons, not least pressure of work, is time. I mean, in the UK, I think the average GP needs to see a patient, listen to everything he's got to say, and diagnose him and write the prescription in a matter of 7 minutes. That's the problem, isn't it? You're bound to make mistakes when you're up against the clock in that way.
Part of it is, I think, that we don't even have a grip on, you know, even that study of how many minutes it takes, there's a variation, right? And there are some places that have figured out how to make more of the time, how to make less of the time. What we see from what little glimpses we have, for example, is an inordinate amount of time is spent on the computer and on the paperwork. With, you know, the one of the recent set of studies showed that the biggest source of loss of morale and burnout in medicine is now the computers. You know, we've become data entry clerks. We can spend as much time in front of that screen as we do in
front
of the patient.
Your doctor spends as much time staring at the screen while you're sitting next to him and not at you.
Yeah, part of the way we then steal the time from you to start doing the data entry even as you're there. You know, I think that we are only beginning to even design our systems. You know, it's like we're 20 years behind. Everybody else has graduated to, you know, much more user-friendly approaches because we daily see the ways we can use our phones and our technologies. but we have not done that at all in medicine and not geared it towards the ways that you make it easier and easier for the reality of a world where we're going to have a larger aging population. We're not going to have more, we're going to have fewer people who are able to care for that population per person. And we have to have ways that we can make it so we're more effective with the time we have and not spending our time just typing in data.
But from something you said during the course of the lecture, money isn't necessarily the answer. In fact, some very high-spending hospitals have, I think according to your research for the New Yorker, rather poorer results.
It depends on where you are in the world. So in India, vastly underspending even for the economy of where it is now. In the UK, it's been, you know, underspent in specialty care, but there's been better investment in primary care in many ways than we've made in the United States. So, you know, in the US we have a very rich system, and yet we have afforded very little support to folks like the primary care doctor back there. Our lowest paid professions are fields like psychiatry and geriatrics, palliative care, the fields that need to spend and have enormous value from spending more time with people. So there is, I think, areas where we have had enormous excess and waste, and then others where it's been just plain misallocated.
I'm going to take a couple more questions. We'll have a gentleman. We'll have the lady at the back there, Ted, where you are. Yeah, and I'll come to you in a second.
Hi, my name is Kathleen Yates, and I'm a researcher in a hospital here in Boston. And I just was kind of hoping to hear some of your thoughts on some of the themes you discussed tonight, mainly those of omniscience and transparency. And it seems like you're really speaking to this trend now in medicine and in science to generate vast quantities of data. And we've kind of talked about, even with some of the questions and answers here, about additional modes of generating that data, whether it's cameras, whether it's computers, and during the interface with patients. But what I'm sort of concerned with is how we begin to parse and interpret that data and these incredible volumes of data that people are now trying to sift through. And, you know, rather than trying to find a needle in a haystack, it's almost like looking for intelligent life in outer space. I just would like to kind of hear your thoughts on
it's
that.
It's a broad question. Can I ask you to be pretty swift on this one, if you possibly can? I ask the impossible.
What I'd say is, you know, part of the reason I'm attracted to writing is because I don't feel like we're, you know, my friend Malcolm Gladwell puts it, that we're data rich and theory poor, that we often don't have our theory and understanding of the story behind what is in the data. And I think we do need to turn the cameras on, do need to be able to bring the audio, the video, the ways of making that come alive. But, you know, what we have to do as people who are both writers or scientists is be able to knit the meaning into the story. And that is going to be the art, in many ways, is the opportunity for young people like you going into the future, is that it won't be enough just to have the data. It's going to be all of these arguments about what it means and being able to make the convincing arguments about how it should be used.
So, gentleman at the back, yeah.
Hi, doctor. My name's Kevin Cullen. I'm a columnist for the Boston Globe, and I just wanted to point out you have enormous credibility in this town because 2 days after the Boston Marathon bombings, you wrote a piece in the New Yorker in which everybody was asking why 3 people died. You wrote why so many lived, because of the services here, and we thank you for that. I bring this question from Dr. Larry Ronan, who's an internist at Massachusetts General Hospital, who could not be here tonight. Dr. Ronan is a great internist, a great humanitarian, and has worked all over the world in the memory of Dr. Tom Durant, who grew up not far from here and was one of the great humanitarian doctors in Boston. Larry asked me to ask you, we mentioned Ebola before, and I think it's something obviously we're going to go beyond your question why doctors fail, why do systems fail? And Dr. Ronan asked me to ask, when you think about what happened after Bandar Aceh, what happened in Indonesia, and what happened in Haiti after the earthquake, there were two very different approaches. In Indonesia, there was much more local control. Everything was thrown at local resources, and local people responded. In Haiti, very often, money was thrown, and local people were sort of ignored and did not get the control that... And I wonder if you've brought, if you've thought about that in your own thinking about how we make doctors and everybody in healthcare succeed when it comes to systems.
It's another big question.
It's big question, yeah. And we really are running out of time. I'm so sorry about this. See what you can do.
Okay. You know, we saw this in a variety of disastrous circumstances. I'll pull out Katrina. So in Hurricane Katrina, you had a very top-down approach with FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, trying to get water into the city. By contrast, Walmart, weirdly enough, got water into the city faster than just about anywhere. And what they did was they told their stores, they had something like 100 stores, that do what you could to figure out solutions. The rules were serve the community first, and then communicate what you're doing to everybody else so they learn as fast as possible. And that allowed them to move outside when the protocols broke down. The rule, the protocol of be transparent and communicate, ended up being the most powerful way that that information spread. And they got water into that area 48 hours before the by-the-book approaches managed to get it in there. We're dealing with the same issue with Ebola in West Africa. The systems were overwhelmed, and then when people locally began asking for help and asking for ways to do it for months, even though they said, this is an outbreak of a kind we've never seen before, no one except Doctors Without Borders responded for months.
Okay, I'm going to take a last quick question. I have my fingers crossed.
My name is Dr. James Baker, and I'm a hospice physician here in Boston. All of my patients are terminally ill, but they don't fear death. Most do not. What they fear most is going back to the hospital for any reason because of the onslaught of what will happen to them. And what do you think will be the pivotal moment to cause us to listen to them and give them what they want instead of what we know how to do?
Well, a couple of things. I hope one moment might be my lecture on this subject at the Reith Lecture, which will be coming up as one of them. But the I think the pivotal moment, and it's a point that I'll get to elaborate on, is I think that the data that we're having is showing that the most important thing we fail to understand is that people have priorities besides just living longer. They have goals and hopes for the quality of the life that they have. The second thing is that the most powerful way to learn about what those priorities are that people have is to ask them. And we don't. And we don't, when we don't, that's the reason they have to fear what might happen. And I think we are still in a global debate about being willing to ask questions that people might have, to ask questions about what their priorities are besides just living longer, and that we can manage to find important lessons that come out of it, that we don't have to be afraid of either being asked those questions or asking those questions.
And there we have to end it. Next week, we'll be in central London at the Wellcome Collection, set up to explore the connections between medicine, life, and art. In his second lecture, Atul will be exploring how better systems can transform global healthcare. Until then, our thanks to our hosts here at the JFK Library in Boston and to this year's Reith Lecturer, Atul Gawande. Don't disappear for 1 second, because we just got to re-record a little bit at the top and we need the acoustic just the same. Do you need the whole introduction? The whole thing? But I had the earrings off. What did I do wrong? There was a pop. But you need the whole thing. Forgive me. you're going to hear the whole introduction again. Oh, we need 5 seconds of silence before it, he says, and then I'll deliver. If there were more light here, we'd be able to see our notes better, don't you think? Okay. Hello and welcome to the first of the 2014 Reith Lectures. We're at the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum in Boston, a dramatic concrete and glass building overlooking Massachusetts Bay, the nation's official memorial to its 35th president. He was a president who inspired a generation with his message of the empowering strength of ideas. Too often, said Kennedy, we enjoy the comfort of opinion without the discomfort of thought. An observation that might have been taken as a text for this year's Reith lecturer, who admits that he's in what he calls the disturbance business. He's a Harvard professor of medicine, so Boston is now his hometown too, but his abilities as a doctor and surgeon are complemented by his skills as a writer, a thinker, and political analyst. And he's become one of the world's leading thinkers on public health. His lectures are called The Future of Medicine, but his subject matter is as much about attitudes, systems, and human behavior as it is about new frontiers in medical research. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the BBC's 2014 Reith Lecturer, Atul Gawande. I think that's fine. They're just going to have a quick check. And Gwyn Williams, who's the controller of Radio 4, would just like a brief word with you before you all disappear. Thank you. Gwyn. No more introductions.
Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for coming tonight to help us launch this Reith Lecture Series. It's wonderful to be here in Boston, especially in your beautiful American fall. I spent the afternoon wandering around Harvard Yard picking up leaves. It's really beautiful here. Thank you. I want to thank Tom again for having us. What a super venue. Really, thank you, Atul. What a lecture. It's going to be an enormous pleasure to broadcast that lecture to Radio 4's 11 million listeners around the UK and on the World Service to the 40 million listeners around the world. So we hope we can generate a powerful debate about the role of medicine and how we might affect global health around the world from your lectures. So we're very, very pleased. And as Sue has said already, these lectures go back to 1948. So I think after tonight, you'll agree that Atul is a proper and welcome addition to that distinguished list of Reith lecturers from Bertrand Russell on. I also want to say a warm welcome to Michael Sandel, who's here, personal welcome. Michael's become a real favorite Radio 4 with his, as our latter-day Socrates, with his public philosopher series. They really are terrific if you ever get to hear them. Thank you, Michael. So, that's it. Thank you to the production team. And most of all, I've got to say thank you very much, Sue, saying go and buy Atul's books and sign them in the thing. Yes, we will. But I've got to say thank you to Sue, our incomparable host. She's loved in the UK, and you can see why. Good night.